When you get hurt, you might think that the first responders on the scene are your friends, your family, or maybe an EMT. But the true first responders to your injuries are found in your innate immune system. CRP, a positive acute phase response protein found in your blood plasma, is one of these first responders, increasing in concentration rapidly in response to inflammation and tissue damage. CRP levels are frequently measured in medicine because they carry a lot of implications about your risk for various illnesses. But we'll get into that later. So what exactly is CRP? CRP was first discovered all the way back in 1930 by scientists William S. Tillett and Thomas Francis. They were studying the body's immune response to pneumococcus, a bacterium which causes infections like pneumonia, bronchitis, and meningitis. Their studies led them to find a substance in the patient's blood serum, which precipitated with the C polysaccharide found in the pneumococcal cell wall. When this substance was later found to be a protein, it was then referred to as the C-reactive protein. Now, almost 90 years after CRP's discovery, scientists have discovered a lot more about this protein. CRP was found to be a member of the pentraxin family, which means that it's a symmetric, circular protein containing five identical non-covalently bound subunits. It has 224 residues, is about 95 angstroms across, and about 35 angstroms in depth. CRP is mainly produced in the liver, though it's been found in other cells as well. Its production is positively regulated at the transcriptional level by interleukin-6, a cytokine produced by macrophages and adipocytes, which signals the activation of transcription factors on chromosome 1, where the CRP gene is located. Okay, so that's a lot of interesting information, but why am I insisting that this is one of your body's first responders? What does it even do? As I said before, CRP is part of your innate immune system, which responds immediately and works in a non-specific manner to get rid of all kinds of pathogens and foreign cells. CRP in particular is a pattern recognition molecule, which predominantly binds to phosphocholine. Phosphocholine is embedded in the cellular membrane of a variety of pathogenic, damaged, or necrotic cells. When CRP binds to this ligand, it opsonizes the cell, which means that it signals for the cell to be taken up by phagocytosis. It does this by initiating the classical complement system, or C1Q pathway. This is a somewhat complicated pathway, so we won't go over this in depth. What is important about the classical system is that it works through a cascade of signal transduction and amplification through various molecules and enzymes. It starts with interaction between the C1Q molecule and CRP, and ends with the production of C3 convertase, a protease which breaks the C3 molecule down into smaller C3B fragments. These fragments then bind to the surface of the pathogen or damaged cell to elicit phagocytosis. There's also evidence that CRP opsonizes cells by binding to Fc gamma receptors on effector cells, but this is yet to be conclusively determined. Let's take a closer look at the molecule itself. CRP binds phosphocholine in a calcium-dependent manner. You can see here, represented by the green orbs, where CRP forms a complex with calcium ions. It also forms a hydrophobic pocket, the two most important residues of which are phenylalanine 66 and glutamate 81. The glutamate also interacts with the positively charged nitrogen of the choline. This is called the recognition face. The other side of the subunit is called the effector face. This is the side which binds C1Q and Fc gamma. The residues important for the binding of these molecules are aspartate 112 and tyrosine 175. The fact that CRP is a highly conserved protein throughout a huge phylogeny of species shows us that this is a very important protein. And of course it is if it gets rid of invading pathogens and dying cells. As I said before, CRP levels can indicate risk of various illnesses due to its linkage to rising inflammation levels in the body. It is predominantly a marker for diabetes and heart disease, but high CRP levels have also been associated with cancer, bacterial infection, sleep apnea, arthritis, and so much more. Knowing CRP levels helps to track the progression of these illnesses and give an assessment from which to base treatment. After 86 years of researching this molecule, scientists are still trying to learn about it. What other ligands and receptors are involved? And what are the possible implications of monomeric CRP? These research topics could mean a lot of important medical discoveries in the future. So really, who's to say that CRP isn't the most important first responder of all?